work back for me when I get back. And I see you cut your hair again. I'm going to have some slippers.
Praise the Lord, everybody. We just want to welcome you into our service, True Vine, as we enter into God's presence with praise and worship. We're going to ask you to join in wherever you are to just give God praise and worship and glorify his name. The song is, and it's an old song. I love to praise him. I love to praise his name. I love to praise him. I love to praise his name. I love to praise him. I love to praise his name. I love to praise his holy name. I love to praise him. I love to praise his name. I love to praise him. I love to praise his name. I love to praise him. I love to praise his name. I love to praise his holy name. He's my rock. My rock, my sword and shield. He's my will. In the middle of a wheel, I know he'll never let me down. He's just a jewel that I have found. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I love to praise his name. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I love to praise his name. I love to praise him. I love to praise his name. I love to praise his holy name. He's my rock. My rock, my sword and shield. He's my will. In the middle of a wheel, I know he'll never let me down. He's just a jewel that I have found. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I love to praise his name. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I love to praise his name. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I love to praise his name. I love to pray. Do you love to? I love to pray in the morning. I love to pray in the noonday. I love to pray late at night. I love to pray. I love to praise his holy name. I love to praise him. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. We love to praise your holy and your righteous name. We're now going to turn it over to Elder Owens with the prayer.
Good morning, church. Today's scripture is going to be coming from the book of Psalms, chapter 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I have read to you Psalms 23 in its entirety. May the Lord have a blessing on the reading, the hearing, and the doing of his word. Now at this time, I'll turn it over to Pastor Doris Burgess for our prayer.
Good morning, True Vine. Praise the Lord, everybody. Let us pray. Father, we thank you today. We give you all honor, all praise, and all glory, God. We just magnify your name, God. We honor you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We bless your name and we honor you, God. Thank you for this day, God. Thank you for your grace and your mercy over us, God. Thank you, God, for your divine protection each and every day. Thank you, God, for your protection on last night as we slumbered, God, and as we slept, oh God. Thank you for awakening us, God, to a new day, God, and enclosed in our right mind, God. And activities of our limbs, God, we just thank you, God. Hallelujah. We just bless your name and honor you, God, for truly you are a great God. Now, Father, we pray, Father God, for those, Father God, who are still stricken with this virus, God. We pray, Father God, for those also, God, that have lost their loved ones, God. We pray, Lord, that you will strengthen them, God. We pray that you would heal, oh God. We're praying, God, that you will heal our land, God. And we're praying that you will help us to trust you, God. I know, Father, that everybody is waiting and wanting to get back to the way it was before. But God, help us to just be still and know that you are God. Help us, oh God, to know, Father God, that you know all and you see all. You are our refuge, our strength, our strong tower, and you will never leave us or forsake us, Father. So we pray, Lord, that you would just help us to keep our eyes up on you, Lord. Help us, oh God, to keep our eyes upon the things above and not the things here on earth. Now, Father, we pray, Lord, for the furtherance of the service. We pray, God, for Bishop, and he brings a word, God. May he untap the hidden mysteries, oh God, as we listen eagerly, oh God. Open our hearts, oh God, to receive, in our ears to hear. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen and amen. Now we will turn it over to Elder Eunice.
Good morning, True Vine and Facebook family. We praise God for you this morning, and I have the honor of introducing our speaker for today, Bishop Trevor Alexander, a man that loves God. He loves his family and humankind. Jeremiah 3 and 15 says, "And I will give you pastors according to my heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding." Well, Bishop Alexander is commissioned by God to serve and feed the assembly, to feed the group, to feed us as we're listening today. So listen attentively as he shares wholesome, sensible words that will help us conduct ourselves productively. God bless Bishop Trevor Alexander.
Well, praise the Lord, Elder Eunice, Elder, as I call it, Elder, so you so nice, Grant. When people introduce you, sometimes you gotta like, who are they talking about? But thank God for Elder Eunice Nice Grant. It has been a wonderful introduction. And I thank God for each of you joining us today on our Facebook land and in this virtual reality. It's not the reality that we're used to, but it is reality we are becoming used to. So thank God for you. I wanna say, before I get into the word, I want to recognize my children, my Tara, my Tasha, and my Tanya. As some of you may know, Tara is still in the hospital, and the overseer, Emma Alexander, is in the hospital with her. That's my beloved wife, the one I'm well pleased with, the one that makes my liver quiver, and my spleen is still clean. Thank God for her, and I thank God for each of you joining us today, and thank God for Pastor David and Doris Burgess, and for Elder Owens and Elder Yusa Nice Grant. And as was mentioned in the prayer, let's continue to pray for one another and pray for those who are stricken with the COVID. I know some of you know people, I've known people, I have family members who are stricken with the COVID. And it's not a joke, y'all. It's not a joke, it's not fake, it's not a hoax. It is for real. Take every precaution that's necessary for us to continue to be in the land of the living and to accomplish the mission that God has placed in our lives. I want to talk to us today for the, and the topic is for such a time as this, for such a time as this. I'm going to read first the Old Testament, which is Esther 4 and 14, and then I'm going to go to the New Testament, Mark 5, 35 through 40. Mark chapter 5, 35 through verse 40. I'm going to give you all a little bit of time to catch up and to get your Bibles, your electronic devices, and whatever you need. So Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask God that you bless our time together. Let this time be productive. As Elder Eunice Grant said, let it be productive, because we are born for such a time as this. So we wrap our mind around the purpose that we are here for, so we can be fruitful and productive. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you should have received, I should have found your word by now, if you're electronic or if you're like me, like those hard copy. So let me do the Old Testament first, Esther chapter 4, verse 14. And this is from the New Living Translation. And it says, if you keep quiet at time like this, deliverance and relief for the Jews will arise from some other place, but you and your relatives will die. Who knows if perhaps you were made queen for such a time as this. All right, let's go to the New Testament, Mark chapter 5, verse 35. And it says, while he was still speaking, him meaning Jesus, some came to the ruler of the synagogue's house and said, your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further? And as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said to the ruler of the synagogue, listen to what he says. Do not be afraid, only believe. And he permitted no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. And verse 40, and they ridiculed him. But when he put them all out, he took the father and the mother of the child and those who were with him and entered where the child was laid. This is the word of God for the people of God, and you all in the virtual land say, thanks be unto God. I want to talk to you again from the topic, for such a time as this. On Wednesday, January the 20th, we as a nation witnessed the inaugural President Joe Biden. Now, don't tune me out. This is not a political message, but I want to link it to what's going in with the sermon. And there were some positive moments that I think as a nation, we all need to just kind of wrap our mind around it so we won't get into this rut of division. And so, again, don't get into the political. Stay in this spiritual mind and receive what I'm trying to say, and don't make it political. We saw a young woman read a poem, a young 22-year-old woman, African-American woman, by the name of Amanda Gordon, recite a poem. I have read that poem in entirety, and I am moved by that poem. I hope the nation heard what she said and be moved just as much as I have moved. But there were some things I want to, some stanzas I want to highlight from the poem. She said that even as we grieve, we grow. that even as we hurt, we hope. That even as we try, as we are tired, we try. That while forever we try together, victorious, not because we will never again know defeat, because we will never again sow division. Man, that's powerful. That is powerful. Then she went on to say this, for there is always light, if only we are brave enough to see it, if only we're brave enough to be it. That links right into what Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue. Only believe. If we can believe it, my brothers and my sisters, if your mind can conceive it, you can believe it. If we can only believe that we were born for such a time as this. And so we have this text before us that we have to wrestle with today. This text says to me that, and I truly believe that we are not here by accident. We are here by design. God has a plan for each of our lives. We are here for such a time as this. It is not by accident that you're listening this morning. It's not by accident that you were born at this time. Think about it. You could have been born at another time, but for some reason, God in his infinite wisdom ordained for you to be born at this time. Amanda Gordon was born for such a time as this. This young woman of 22 years old was thrust into the public light, and everybody is talking about her poem. Every news channel that I visit is talking about her poem. Her calendar is quickly filling up because she was produced for such a time as this. The Vice President of the United States of America, the first woman and the first woman of color to hold that position, was born for such a time as this. My question to you today, it may sound simple, but it's complex. Do you know that you were born for such a time as this? Let me try and connect the dots to with the text and what's going on in our lives and what's going on in our nation. Let me try and connect the dots. So let's have the discussion. Jairus is the leader of the synagogue. You got to read the entire text of chapter 5. He's the leader of the synagogue. Jesus gets off of the boat. He approaches Jesus and tells Jesus that his daughter of 12 years old is sick, and he wants Jesus to come and heal her. Jesus has accepted an unscheduled assignment. Jairus was not Jesus's assignment. And I'll talk about it a little later on, but he was going someplace else. Matter of fact, I'm gonna tell you right front. He was going back to Nazareth. He was going home, but Jairus interrupted Jesus' journey, and Jesus accepts this unscheduled appointment to heal his daughter. While he was going with Jairus to Jairus' house, the woman with the issue of blood presses her way through the crowd and interrupts him once again. And y'all know the story. She touches Jesus's hem of the garment and she's healed. And Jesus said, "Who touched me?" But I want you to hear the connection. She had been sick for 12 years. The young girl, Jairus' daughter, is 12 years old. This woman has been sick for 12 years. They are not the primary focus of Jesus' assignment. The young woman and the young girl, the woman that issued blood and the young girl, they are not the primary reason for Jesus' assignment. They interrupt Jesus' assignment, but because they were born for such a time as this, Jesus made a variation of his schedule, and out of that variation, you saw healing coming forth. Jesus, while the woman touches his garment, he's having a conversation with her. And while he's talking to her, a word from Jairus' house came to Jairus and said, "Your daughter is dead." Why trouble you, the master? Why trouble you, the teacher? Let me park here and take some symbolic liberty and work with this little pause right now. Jairus is a father, and he's one of the leaders of the synagogue. He interrupts Jesus. Jesus is going to his house for the healing of his daughter. While on the journey, the woman with the issue of blood interrupts Jesus and causes a delay of the healing for his daughter. Mm-hmm. She gets healed. Now, I don't know this for sure, but he is the leader of the synagogue. I'm pretty sure at some point, if this woman was not a member of the synagogue, their path may have crossed. So there's a bittersweet moment going on here. As the leader of a synagogue, a spiritual man, I'm pretty sure he was excited for the healing of this woman. But the bitter part is you interrupted the journey and your delay may have caused my daughter to die. Here's a bittersweet moment. What do you do when it looks like all that you have planned is not working for you? And if this time schedule has speeded up, everything would have worked out as planned. But this woman interrupted Jesus, caused a delay, and his daughter dies. He wants to celebrate. He wants to celebrate. He wants to give all the accolades. He wants to celebrate, but he's in pain because his daughter had just died. That's a bittersweet. There's a bittersweet. Let me kind of park here parenthetically once again. I see a striking resemblance between Jairus and our nation. While many people were celebrating and cheering President Biden as the new president, the 46th president of the United States of America, there were some, mainly Republicans, at home wanting to celebrate because we had a peaceful transition, but they could not celebrate because they were in pain at the disappointment of a loss. There's a bittersweet. You want to celebrate, but you can't celebrate because you are suffering the pain. I'm here to tell you that there is hope in this text. I don't care if you're Democrat or you're a Republican. Their interruption of the journey did not stop Jesus. The interruption of whatever the plans that you thought was going to happen didn't stop us as a nation, because we are not a nation based on a president. We are a nation based on the Constitution of the United States of America. And so as Jesus continued on his journey, we're going to continue on. And as an old preacher told me not too long ago, we've been through this before and we will make it through. All right, so we will survive. Here's a theological connection. So I suggest to you for your consideration that this is not just a story of healing, but a story of the connectivity of two women. All right, let me see if I can work this out. One woman, well, here's part of the significance. We don't know the names of either one of these young women, either Jairus' daughter or the woman with the issue of blood. And it's not, they are significant, but it's not important that we know their name. Theologically, one of the things that is so great about not knowing their names is where you insert your name. And so the woman had been suffering with the issue of blood for 12 years. Jairus' daughter is 12 years old. If those who study neurology understand that there are 187 times that the number 12 have been mentioned in God's word. 12 is considered to be the perfect number that symbolizes God's power and authority. 12 is known as the perfect governmental foundation. For example, there are 12 tribes, 12 gates in the city. There are 12 disciples. When Jesus fed the 5,000, there were 12 baskets left over. So if you were of the mindset, especially of a Jewish mindset, whenever you heard the word 12 or read the word 12, there was an instant connotation that no, this is God's perfecting time. And so here's the intersection today. This woman is 12 years, this young girl is 12 years old. This woman was sick for 12 years, and both of them are facing the possibility of death. The woman with the issue of blood has suffered as long as this young girl has been alive. There's a connection, there's a connection, there's a connection. What's the connection? The interconnection is Jesus. It didn't happen just by accident. Nothing in Jesus' life happens by accident. It's all orchestrated and designed. We are in the moment, the Kairos moment, that Jesus is heading to one place. And then you have the Chronos and the Kairos and the intersect, and the intersection is Jesus. The Chronos is chronological time. I mean, yes, the Chronos is and the Kairos is God's time. And there was an intersection. So here's the interconnectivity. The first interconnectivity is this woman and this young girl. The young girl's father is a leader in a synagogue. She would have all access to the best of care. We can call her an insider, right? She's got instant connections to all of the leadership in the synagogue because of the position of her father. Oh my God, that just blessed my soul. Because we can be considered insiders because we have connection to the father and we're insiders. Because when we pray, we believe that when we pray, he hears us, right? And if he hears us and he calls us children and he said, we are his beloved and he calls us friends, there are so much language in the text in the Bible that talks to us and speaks to us and tells us we are his own. And he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me that I am his own. Oh my God, we are his own. We are insiders. Now we come to the woman issue of blood. Because of her condition, she was not allowed to go into the synagogue. She had the issue of blood. She could be considered as an outsider. So we have the tension between the insider and the outsider. And there's an interconnection. There's an interconnection. We see that in a minute. This woman, the woman with the issue of blood, would have been treated as an outcast, a part of the throwaway society, part of the undesirable, the untouchable. Because of the law of Moses, she was so untouchable that anybody touched her would be considered unclean. So for 12 years, she had not known the joy of having the human touch. My heart is going out right now because for those who are suffering from the COVID, those are in ICU, only human touch they know are from the strangers, from the nurses, from the doctors, but the human touch of family members who are not able to journey with them in the ICU, who are not able to journey with them, had to stop at the door. There's a pain involved of being isolated and being an untouchable. This woman, because of her condition, had to practice social distancing. Yeah, you see the connection. She had to practice social distancing. She had to yell unclean and people had to spread from her because she was unclean. Yes, this woman was practicing social distancing, but she pressed her way and touched the hem of Jesus' garment and she received her healing. This woman broke down the barriers to get to Jesus. The young girl, because of her position of the father, would have received the best of care and would have received everything necessary and she would have been accepted, but the woman would have been, with the issue of blood, would have been rejected. She was so broken, she could not enter the doors of the place that we go to pray to connect to God. But she understood that there's favor in touching Jesus right where he was. Wherever you are, there's favor in reaching out to God. And here's a beautiful thing. Oh my God, wherever he is, you are, because you can create your own spiritual atmosphere. Here's the third part of this interconnectivity. These two women are interconnected through time. As I said, we don't know their name, but they both are in need of healing. They both need something that they could not provide for themselves. And Jesus was that interconnectivity. Jesus provided the interconnectivity between time and reality. Others saw Jesus and were celebrating. Jairus saw Jesus and saw the master. The woman saw Jesus and saw healing. Jesus was the bridge between time and reality. Healing does not happen without Jesus being in the presence. This is not the first time that we will see Jesus being that bridge between time and reality. There's interconnectivity when Jesus is hung on the cross. He is suspended between time and reality. He is suspended between heaven and earth. And this suspension between time and reality caused a death, but from the death comes a resurrection. Woo! Because you see the resurrection happening in the time and reality of the young girl who's already dead. But when the interconnectivity of Jesus shows up on the scene, the impossible becomes possible. All right, let me get to my next point. What do you do while you are caught up in between what you believe and what you see? What do you do when you're caught up between what you believe and what you see? Here's a question I want to ask you today. What do you do while you're waiting on Jesus to move on your behalf? You've received the word. God is going to do something for you. You are in this predicament. You pray for Jesus. You're waiting and he doesn't seem to be moving. What do you do when you're wanting Jesus to move and he seems like he's taking his time? What do you do when Jesus takes his time and you're in a hurry? Dr. Samuel Chan says in his book, New Thinking, New Future, and I love this statement. He says, the middle of the journey is when enthusiasm wanes and difficulty has surfaced. He said, it's in the middle of that journey, the in-between, where we begin to suffer the reality of what we see and what we hope for. He said that enthusiasm begins to wane because sometimes the problems outweigh the hopes. But this is the challenge. Let me give four quick points and we'll move on. What we can do. And it's in the text. It's in the text that we read today. The first point is, don't be afraid. Jesus said in verse 36, after Jairus had received the word that his daughter was dead, he says to him, don't be afraid. No matter what's going on in the job market, don't be afraid. No matter what's going on in the stock market, don't be afraid. No matter who's in the White House, don't be afraid. No matter what you hear about the COVID-19 and all the numbers are going up and who all the people are dying, don't panic by what you hear. Follow the guidelines. Do everything you're supposed to do, but don't be afraid. The second point is, and again, these are quick points. The second point is, and it's in verse 36, only believe. First point, don't be afraid. Second point, only believe. Now, Jesus is giving direction to Jairus, and he tells him, don't be afraid. Then he says, only believe. This is after Jairus' daughter is dead, and Jesus is giving direction. And he says, now, this is a statement of singularity, but you're supposed to receive it and understand it in the plural sense. Let me see if I can break this down. In the singularity sense, you focus on the point or a person. In a plural sense, you have to have multiple areas of focus. Let me give you how you can understand the singularity of vision, or we can call it the double vision, right? You focus on the vision that God gave you while keeping an eye on the God. That's a double vision. God gave us two eyes. We can see out with the left eye and the right eye, and we have a peripheral vision. We see beyond what our spaces of focus, but we also to see the peripheral. Now, here's the joy. Because we can read the statement of singularity with a pure mindset, when Jesus says, only believe, he uses the word only. Not just believe, but only believe. That's a statement of singularity, only. But you got to understand it in the plural. Only believe, but since I'm here, focus on me. So your belief system has to marry with the one that gives you and the source of your belief system. Come on here. So she's dead, but don't worry about it. If you believe and focus on me, things are going to turn around. The third point is take only the people that will benefit you on your journey. Take only the people who will benefit you on your journey. And verse 37, Jesus takes with him Peter, James, and John. Not everybody that wants to journey with you has the ability to withstand what you have to withstand. They don't have the stamina to stay with you. Now, I'm not a runner long distance. I hear somebody laughing right now. I used to run back in the day, 200, 400, 100, I'm a sprinter, right? Now, when you're running with a cross distance person or a marathoner, you got to be able to keep up with them. But if you don't have the stamina, you're gonna fall behind. Not everybody who wants to journey with you has the stamina to walk with you. when Jesus says to Jairus, don't be afraid, only believe, and he takes with him Peter, James, and John, and he leaves the crowd behind. Sometimes you got to be willing to leave some people behind. Interestingly enough, Jesus only takes Peter, James, and John with him. And if you understand the scriptures, if you understand the scriptures, understand the New Testament, Peter, James, and John are significant in furthering the gospel. While Jesus dies and resurrected, and he goes to be with the Father and is seated at the right hand of the Father, he relies on those who he had trained to further the gospel. And Peter, James, and John, the one that he takes with him to the young girl's home, is the ones who help further the gospel. Take with you only the people who can believe with you. Take with you people who can pray for you and with you. And take with you people that has your back. Here's my fourth and final point. Take inventory and clean house. Take inventory and clean house. Verse 40 says, and they ridiculed him. But when he had put them out, when he had put them all outside, he took with him the father and the mother of the child and those he brought with him and entered the place where the young girl was laying. Jesus was about to perform a miracle. And the first thing he did, he evicted the naysayers. Take inventory and clean your house. He evicted the naysayers because what he's about to do, you don't need people around you to speak negativity. Last night, Tanya and I and Phoenix were playing a game. I forgot the name, but it's like Sorry. And so Phoenix was kind of giving me some hint. And Tanya said, okay, I feel all this negativity coming towards me. Can I get some positivity? If you are going to do the work of the Lord, you need some people around you who can encourage you. You don't need no negative people. Evict the negative people. Evict the naysayers. They may have been good at one point, but where God is taking you to this next point, it's going to cause your belief system to expand, enlarge your territory, enlarge your tent, because God is going to take you someplace you have never been. R. Kent Hughes, in his book, Disciples of God, A Disciple of God's Man, says, when you begin to believe God, other people around you begin to think you're losing your mind. Ain't that funny? As you begin to believe God, other people around you will think you're losing your mind. Why? Because you believe in God to do the impossible, and whatever they see you believing in just don't make sense to them. So you got to evict the naysayers, and so your belief system can grow and be productive. Ellie, you use a nice grant, so I can be productive. We believe God because we believe we are special in his eyes, and he hears our prayer. And when he hears our prayer, and he's in tune to our prayer, and we're in tune to God's heart, he will do what we are praying for. That's one of the joy of being a believer. And so we are in this place now that we got to believe God like never before. We got to elevate our belief system. Let's not be afraid. Only believe. Take people with you who you know have your back, and evict the naysayers, and take inventory and clean house. My friends, I'm closing. You and I are born for such a time as this. Don't get discouraged that you don't look like where God is taking you. You don't look like what God has showed you. Don't get discouraged, because you are about to enter into a season, because you were born for such a time as this. This season of change is coming. I know this. We're hearing all this negative stuff about there's another strand of the virus is coming. It may be worse than the first one. I hear it. But you were born for such a time as this. You're about to see some things turn around in your life. You're about to see some fantastic things happening because it's your season and your turn. These two nameless women that was mentioned in the text both have suffered. And over 2,000 years later, We are not talking about them by name. We're talking about the healing they receive, but we understand that healing came from being interconnected with Jesus. Ah, my God, the impact that these women have made in our lives, we are still learning from their lessons. Their names doesn't matter. But what matters is the impact they have made in our lives. I tell my students all the time, I don't teach to impress them, I teach to impact them. We are here and born for such a time as this. Have you ever wondered why you were not born in the 50s? Why you're not born, well, some of y'all are born in the 50s. Why you're not born in the 20s? You're not born in the 1800s, in the 1700s. But you were born right now. You are ready here right now in the midst of COVID-19, in the midst of the pandemic. You are born because God ordained it for you to be born for such a time as this. You are born to make an impact. You are born to make a difference. You are born for such a time as this. Dr. Sam said, God gave the tortoise and the horse the same amount of time to get into the ark. My friends, I gotta read it again, just bless me. God gave the tortoise and the horse the same amount of time to get into the ark. My friends, don't get discouraged because you see other people making it before you. Don't get discouraged before you see them making it before you. Stay the course. Have a singularity of vision, or what I want to call the double vision. Singularity with the eyes focused on the Lord, having an eye also on the vision that God has given you. Amanda Gordon has aspirations to become the president of the United States. She plans to run, I believe it's 2036. She plans to run. Madam Vice President Harris is 56 years old. Amanda is 22 years old. The vice president right now is the horse. Amanda is the tortoise. But the horse is laying down the foundation. So when the tortoise get there, as slow as the tortoise may be, as sure as the tortoise is, she or he will get to the point where God has ordained them to be. And sometimes we need pioneers to go before you and make the crooked way straight and the high places low. So when you get there, you don't have to fight as hard as we have fought for others to get there. All right, let me put it on. Those of us of older, we have laid down a foundation for the younger ones to come in. The battle's not over yet. We still have much more to do. We still have much more to fight for. But I gotta say this and say this, Our hopes is not tied up in the White House. Our hopes is tied up in God's house. He has made us all. He is the reason why we're here. He ordained us to be born for such a time as this. And I'm here to tell you that when the wise men came, they were following the star, but they made a mistake and stopping over the palace, because that's the way they thought the king would be. Let us not make the same mistakes and thinking that all the answers come from the White House. Our answers come from God's house. If my people who are born for such a time as this will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, that's one of the reasons we're here, to seek his face and humble ourselves and pray. Then we can hear from the one that gives us the joy and the energy and our lifeline. We can hear from him and he'll heal our land. We were born for such a time as this. The White House can set policies, but let me tell you something. You and I are powerful because when we hear from God and enact what God has asked us to do, we are just as powerful as the White House. We can change policies. We can create opportunities by being at the right place at the right time because you were born for such a time as this. So don't get discouraged. Don't lose hope. Don't lose heart because you are critical for the next stage that God has taken us. I'm here to tell you it's going to be wonderful. I'm here to tell you that it is wonderful. I don't have my wife here today, but I know she's listening. I'm missing my rib because my rib normally comes alongside with me and we can have this discussion. But those of you who heard me today, understand that this is critical time and you are critical to God. You are so critical. You were born for such a time as this. Don't let nobody come and discourage you because you are ready for the master's use. So my friends, you were born for such a time as this. Listen, I can't wait to have a discussion with you all as we enter into the sermon discussion after the sermon at 11:30. If you want to join us in this discussion, put a comment in the chat and we get you the Zoom link so we can chime in and have a discussion. So I'm ready to interact because God is getting ready to do some stuff in True Vine. We are positioned just right to receive what God is getting ready to do. My God, I want to get a little graphic. When a woman's getting ready to give birth, you got to get in the birthing position. I believe True Vine is in the birthing position, ready to receive. Are you ready? Are you ready? Listen, if you're ready to be a disciple, if you're ready to receive what God has for you, let's do the A, B, C, D. A, believe that you were born for such a time as this, and Jesus is the Lord. Accept him as Lord. B, oh my God, you got to believe that he is the Son of God. C, confess your sin, and D, become a disciple. Not a bench warmer, but somebody who's willingly and ready to become active in the plans of God. If you're here today and you heard it, put a comment and one of the elders of the month will reach out to you and we will engage you in the chat. And then we put you in the virtual reality where we can disciple you. Let me pray real quickly. Father, in the name of Jesus, we are thankful and grateful for what you have said. You told us that we are born for such a time as this. So as we come now, Father, bless our time together. Make this virtual reality matter in our lives. Touch those that will tune in, that are tuning in right now, and those that will tune in later. Help them to understand they are critical to your plans. And they were born for the reality of such a time as this. You didn't make a mistake, God, and you didn't create no junk. We are part of the plan that you have for our lives. Jeremiah told us that each of us have a plan, and you've ordained this plan of good and not evil. So we thank you, God, for what you're about to do. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Listen, tonight at 6 o'clock, Overseer Emma will join her at 6 for Words for the Soul. She's going to have some conversation with two people. We said it last week, but those who didn't join in, about what the COVID journey is like. We have two people who've been through the journey and they're going to share their experiences. You don't want to miss it. Tune in tonight. Once you understand the journey, helps us to know how to pray. We can tune in and harness that focus of singularity, having a pure mindset. Yes. So tune in tonight at 6. God bless you is our prayer. In Jesus' name, we see you later. Bye-bye.